then, first of all, let me check, are you all able to hear me? Then let me first say that we are gathering here to remember and honor Raymond Abbott. And because this is a time of reflection and being here in a sacred space, I ask first that if you have any cell phones, please turn them off, put them on silent. Often on a Sunday morning, we will welcome that and make it a fun and joyful accidental speaking of God into this space. But today, let us be present to Ray in all the ways that we can be present to him and honor his life. We welcome you here to Jackson Community Church. Raymond Abbott was the fifth generation of his family to be born here, to live here, to work and be passionate here, to raise his family here, and now to be remembered here and buried here. Please join me now in a moment of prayer. Oh God, we come into your presence. You are the God of our going out and our coming in. And every day in between, you ask to hold our lives in your keeping. Today, we return to you the love and the life of Raymond Abbott, who has had a long and storied presence here in this valley and around the world. He is a child of God, a man fashioned in your image, claimed and known by you, and now reclaimed by you into that home that you promised beyond this one. We ask that you be present to those who remain here, who love him and remember him, and that the fingerprints of his life should go on in the lives of those who have been touched by him in so many ways. His son Marshall and his daughter Geisha, his grandchildren, his beloved friends, Pam, all those in his life that he worked with and played with, God, we ask that you let each of us carry out a little bit of his light back into the world today. And that you offer your comfort and your healing and your resilience to all those who honor him. In your name we pray. Amen. Ray Abbott didn't want a big fancy service. I'm sure that many of you have stories about how you knew him and held him in affection or differed in opinion with him. But he asked that we not open this up to many, many stories. And so there will be a time with the red box later today where you can have all the stories that you didn't say here in this space this morning. And raise a glass and enjoy having been his friend and his family. This morning, we invite you to sing together the song Amazing Grace, which you can find on page 401 in the red hymnal here in the pews. Please share. We'll do the first, second, and final verse. How's that sound? One, two, and five. Please rise and hear me.
Thank you.
share with you now a scripture that has been a long traditional source of comfort for thousands of years to people of faith. This is Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil. For you are with me, you are my rod, and you are my staff, and they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, and my cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long. So ends the reading. And although we do not open up the service today to all those stories that you may have, and we do encourage you to think about and bring those stories to the reception later, we do want to share with you a few of the stories about how Raymond Abbott was present to his family and to this community and to this country. Raymond Abbott assisted with his own biography by writing more than one resume. One of them was written in all caps. And you can tell what is important to him by what he wrote and how much space it was given. He was proud of being a New Hampshire native and a Jackson son, the fifth generation raised in his homestead. And the very next lines of his resume were all about the greatest love of his life, which was his family. He talked about his daughter Geisha and his son Marshall. We know that he loved politics, and we know that he loved flying, but his family was his greatest passion. He wrote at least once to his son, "You know I love you, but it's hard for me to say it or to show it." And yet, not surprisingly, among his most cherished possessions, alongside a lifetime of honors and achievements, were the first cards and the first letters written in their own handwriting by his granddaughters, Brooke and Emma and Anna. Alongside the communications and the cards and the memorabilia and the images that spelled out his love and his connection to his children, Geisha and Michael, to Marshall, and to their spouses, Michael and Angela. Of all the things, of all the merits and the honors that he won, all the citations and awards that he earned and received, children writing their own first name in their own handwriting was his most precious possession. And so I say to all of you, your grandfather loved you, your father loved you, and love does not die. Love lives on in you and the generations that continue beyond you as it continued down into Ray's life. And you carry that love within you, and you continue to be the fingerprints and the breath and the footprints of his love in the world. One of the words that was used to describe him was tough old bird. And maybe we would say that he's a tough old bird because he's independent and stubborn and loyal and patriotic and hardworking and, yes, opinionated. From what I can gather, people were never in the middle of the road about how they felt and understood their connection to Ray. He was a polarizing type of man. And yet he merited our respect, and you can see that by a room filled with those who have come to honor him today. In part, he was able to live and to die on his own terms. And that comes because he was tied so deeply to this community and this valley. It's a testament to this village and this community and this valley that he was able to stay in his own home until the last few months of his life. The place where he was born and raised, and where he raised his own children. Because it was friends and neighbors that helped him live there so long. That's why the Gibson Senior Center is listed as the preferred cause for his family, because they helped connect him to things like Meals on Wheels, whose volunteers delivered meals to him every day and brought him the headlines of the Conway's Daily Sun, and visited with him and helped to support him in his autonomy. There are members of this community that gave him rides when he couldn't drive himself. And one friend who faithfully went and collected his mail and delivered it to him when he couldn't get down to the post office. All that he gave into this village and this valley was returned to him so that he could be here for as long as possible. When he was taken to the hospital just a few weeks ago, he was considered to be non-communicative. And yet when Marshall arrived and went around the bed, Ray opened his eyes and said, I hope I'm getting this right. What the hell are you doing here? Not because he didn't want his son to be present, but because he prided himself on being this independent, tough old bird. And he didn't want to be a burden or a trouble to others. And yet, the night before he died, when he wouldn't talk to anyone else, he knew when his own child was in the room and he spoke to him. And so again, that tells you who and what was important to Raymond Abbott, his children. On his resume, his service in Korea only receives one line. He was a B-29 Super Fortress pilot. But really, we know that he joined the Air Force because he loved to fly. He learned to fly at the age of 16 here in Conway, and he joined the military after high school. At least once, as a pilot of the B-29, while flying the mission, his plane was shot, and they returned flying to their airbase without a windshield. And he sustained very serious injuries during his service in Korea. And yet he didn't talk about it a whole lot. And it wasn't the passion that took up most of the space in his resume. It was his love of flying that took him there and brought him back here, among other things. If you look in your bulletin, you will see that there is an Air Force poem. It was written by, I think it was a Canadian pilot. Maybe actually a British pilot. But it's been adopted by several Air Forces all over the world. And it expresses the exuberance of pilots and their love for flying. And isn't that really what carried Ray's safety back to Japan, along with all of his crew members? And brought him then back into this place, into our lives, where he went on to have a long and storied career. When he came back from military, he was running Abbott's Ski Lodge, where I'm sure both of his children put in their time caring for guests. He was running Abbott Variety Store, which used to be yesterday, complete with a soda fountain. We know that he helped build Wildcat. In fact, he would tell you that he was there when they cut the first trees and blazed the first trails and served as their director and their operations manager for 21 years. He had his hands in all kinds of businesses and endeavors. He owned Conway Tractor and Equipment. He worked for North Conway Bank. He volunteered and helped charter things like the junior branch of the Chamber of Commerce here in the Valley. He worked with Small Business Administration and worked for development initiatives in Vermont and New Hampshire. That's what he did during the day to work, but it was his joy and his passion that we really remember. We know that he loved the skiing, the Wildcat, that whole part of his life, and we know that he loved flying. When he came back here, he owned another plane. He co-owned it. It was a Mooney that he flew out of North Conway. He served on the state's aeronautics and air resources as commissioner for New Hampshire, and he belonged to several organizations that had to do with flying. But I'm guessing you won't be surprised that the preponderance of his resume was taken up by public service and politics. Ray was patriotic, and he put in his time into the pursuits that reflected his values. In Jackson, he served as a selectman, moderator, a school district moderator. In Carroll County, he was a commissioner. He served as a sheriff and a deputy sheriff. He served on various commissions. And for the Republican Party, he worked on local campaigns. He worked on municipal government. He worked on presidential campaigns. He served on the Citizens for a New America Committee under Ronald Reagan. And in fact, his family would tell you there is an entire room of the homestead that is probably now really called the Ronald Reagan Room, because of the number of photos and memorabilia collected from his time working with and serving that president as well as many others. He changed our country. He served it as a pilot, but then he went on to continue serving it in the ways that he believed. He was committed, and he lived out what he believed. Whether you agree with him or not, it doesn't matter. He was here, and he shaped the world. One of his great moments of pride was receiving the Norris Kopp Award, which is given by the Republican Party of New Hampshire to those who go above and beyond assisting the party and their candidates. I think I've probably told you a few things that you know more about Ray than I do. Each of you in your own way has so many stories about how you knew him, how he was your friend and your neighbor, sometimes your opponent or your adversary. But he modeled what it means to live and believe in what you believe in. Do it and love those deeply, passionately, who are your family, who are your friends. At the service today, and during the graveside service, we invite you to celebrate his life, remember him with honesty and affection, and maybe with graveside vows, to share your stories and to make a toast in his honor at the Red Fox. We will be leaving from here to go to the cemetery. If you're comfortable going there, the Air Force will be conducting their honors with the flag. We will be saying another prayer at the graveside, and we will go from there to the Red Fox, where we will all tell our stories about a man that none of us is going to forget, and we are all here to celebrate and to honor. I invite you now to simply listen to the Air Force anthem, which is again filled with that same exuberance that you see in the poem Half Life. The wild and young is the Air Force anthem. We send you out with the words from High Flight as the benediction. I split the surly bonds of earth and dance the skies on laughter silver wings. Sunward I climbed and joined the tumbling mirth of sun-split clouds and done 100 things you have not dreamed of. Wheeled and soared and swung high in the sunlit space. Hovering there, I chased the shabby wind along and flung my eager craft through footless halls of air. Up the long, delirious, burning blue, I topped the windswept heights with easy grace, where never lark or eagle flew. while the silent, lifting mind I trod the high, untrespassed sanctity of space, put out my hand and touched the face of God. Friends, Raymond Abbott has gone ahead of us into that place where he has touched the face of God and been touched by the face of God. And we wish for each of you now that you may have the chance to feel that same amazing joy and freedom at some time in your life, and to know that sense of coming home, and to fly and stand and live again in the presence of God. Until then, may you go in peace, held in the light and the love and the comfort of the Prince of Peace. Go in peace. Amen.